Good afternoon. Today's topic is ABCDEF Bundle Improvement Collaboration. And the whole greater than the sum of the parts? That's the question. Okay. This is a Twitter room. And so during the conference, the Twitter handle is ICU Liberation. And we have a Twitter moderator. And so what's going to happen is the Twitters that are presently on the screen, that screen is, and you're not going to be able to see that. The moderator is going to do it. And when we get to the question section, they'll summarize, and so your feedback will input into the questions and answers. Okay. All right. So this is an exciting presentation. We're going to be doing ICU Liberation Collaborative Building Blocks for Positive Change, then going into teamwork and communication connections, adding the F word to the ABCDEF bundle, putting it all together, the ABCDEF Improvement Collaborative preliminary findings, and then we'll wrap it up with a panel. So first, we'll start off with ICU Liberation, Building Blocks for Positive Change.
Well, good afternoon. Hope everybody's having a good day. And my name is Wes Ely. I work at Vanderbilt University, and I'm one of the leaders of the FCCM's ICU Liberation Collaborative. Very thankful to have such a robust number of people in the room today to talk with us about this move within critical care that involves maturation of how well we take care of sick people. The PAD guidelines, of which I was one of the authors of the 2013 version, are currently being redone, and there's a huge committee of people working on reissuing the PAD guidelines that will come out in early 2018. In the meantime, the Society of Critical Care Medicine, tried to figure out how can we best mobilize all of these healthcare professionals around the country and world to do an implementation of these guidelines and essentially improve care as much as possible with the available information. And that's what became ICU Liberation. So for those in the room not familiar, ICU Liberation is a collaborative of hospitals that are organized in three territories of the United States: the West, the Midwest and Northeast, and then the Southeast. And these hospitals, I'm assuming, how do I move forward here? There we go. These hospitals are scattered from around the United States. They were chosen from among many who applied, and we actually were going to take many fewer hospitals than this originally, but so many hospitals wanted to be a part of this collaborative that we actually expanded the number of hospitals accepted. You can see every place there's an H, then those are hospitals in that region taking on this idea of implementing the PAD guidelines via a bundle, which I'm going to get into in just a minute. Now, around this two-year collaborative, the way that things are organized were continuing medical education, feet on the ground, how do we do the building blocks of implementation to improve care, then data collection of baseline, where's our performance at the beginning, how are we doing with our teamwork, healthy work environment, that sort of thing. And then now in the winter and spring of 2016, we're feeding back information to the individual sites so that they can find their own problem spots and ways of improving their own performance, work environment, etc. And we're now prospectively collecting data as we implement change across these ICUs, which we'll get into throughout this symposium today, to see if we can track improvements in process measures. Process measures that have been proven in the literature to be ways of improving patient outcomes related to length of stay, mortality, long-term cognition, delirium, etc. I throw this triangle up here, this pyramid, not so that you necessarily read each piece of it, but to remind you of your college or high school psychology class. Back in the day when we were young, I'm one of the older people in the room here with all of my gray hair, but back in the day when you took psychology, you were taught something called Maslow's hierarchy. Maslow's hierarchy of needs starts at the very bottom of this triangle, where we see physiological needs, moves up to safety, love and belonging, esteem, and self-actualization. And about 2 years ago, we published a paper called Applying Maslow's Hierarchy of Needs to the Critical Care Environment. And I showed this triangle today. I don't show it very often, but this pyramid, to help you all realize that ICU liberation is all about embracing the concept that critical care has matured in many, many ways, which have allowed us to no longer focus only on the bottom portions of this pyramid. And when critical care first came about in the 70s, 80s, and even then into the early 90s, all we were trying to do was keep people's physiology normalized, their oxygenation, their blood pressure, and keep them safe. We were essentially, as an ICU field, if you will, we were operating at the very bottom of human needs, physiology, safety. And now, as we have gotten more and more data, especially in the adult world, but now coming in the pediatric world as well, that help us to understand how to get beyond physiology and safety into the more humane aspects of critical care, then we've moved into love and belonging, self-esteem, and self-actualization. So the ICU Liberation Collaborative, if somebody off the streets wanted to know what it was about, I would tell them, well, it's a group of healthcare professionals who've gotten together and tried to figure out how can we do a better job of magnifying human dignity and preserving self-worth. So that's essentially, in a nutshell, what we are trying to do with the FCCM ICU Liberation Collaborative. And one of the ways that this gets done, I'm going to focus now just on one of the team members in the ICU, the nurses. The nurses are a huge piece of this story. So, for example, this quote by Bud Relman, who was the editor of the New England Journal for many, many years, when he was passing away in this past year, he wrote, "I had never before understood how much good nursing care contributes to patient safety and comfort, especially when they are very sick and disabled," because he had become a patient himself. And so he's reflecting back on his own experience. "This is a lesson all physicians and hospital administrators should learn. When nursing is not optimal, patient care is never good." And I decided in these few minutes that I have with you, before I turn it over to the other colleagues of mine who are going to present to you, that I would focus on three things. One is that individual team members in your ICU make a huge difference. For example, the nurses. They will make a massive difference if they become leaders themselves, if they are given the autonomy to do what they were trained to do, and to really rise up. Like the Andra Day song. I don't know if you guys saw Andra Day on the Grammys, but she's amazing. In her song, Rise Up, they have to rise up in your unit and do what they know how to do, but not be suppressed by any other team member, typically an egotistical physician. I can say that because I know about the ego of physicians, and I'm constantly trying to keep my own in check. If you look at this classic picture provided to me by Heidi Engel from UCSF, back from the late 60s, I think, you can see this nurse walking this patient on the ventilator. This woman intubated, walking around in the unit at UCSF. In many ways, we have to come back and come full circle back to what we knew at the beginning of critical care, which was that human beings are meant to get out of bed. They're meant to be vertical and not tied down with physical and chemical restraints. Human dignity arises from them being able to get on with their life, even though they're not completely past their critical illness. So a large part of ICU liberation is emboldening the nurses, empowering the nurses, like you see this nurse here, to do a basic element of nursing care, which is human mobility. And not saying in our ICU, hey, if we don't have a dedicated physical therapist, then we won't embrace the E, the early mobility part of our bundle. Because in truth, the next data I'm going to show you in the next couple of slides will show you that there is a dose response, that the higher portion of the bundle that you implement in your unit, the better result you're going to see in terms of survival, and in terms of, for example, reducing delirium and coma. So I'm going to show you some original data that were just for the first time presented yesterday by Marianne Barnes-Daly, who's sitting here on the front row. She's tackling the F component of the bundle. So since she's not going to cover this large of a section, I got to steal her data to brag on her a bit. And this bundle, the A to F bundle, which is, this is a screenshot from our ICU delirium website where you can go and read more about this. But the A in assessing for pain, B, both SATs and SBTs, C, choice of drugs, D, delirium monitoring and management, and E, early mobility, followed by the all-important F, family incorporation and empowerment. This bundle, way too much to cover in here on whole, so we want to give you the resources, either this ICU Delirium website or, and especially, go to the ICU Liberation website, www.iculiberation.org. Now, when Marianne Daly decided to implement throughout the Sutter Health Program, 7 different ICUs and over 6,000 patients, almost 15,000 patient days, what we learned from that implement, that large-scale implementation program of the A to F bundle, is that as you go across the x-axis on both of these graphs, you see that both curves go up. Okay. Now, the x-axis is percents of compliance with the bundle, going from 0 to 10, 20, 50, 70, 80, 90 to 100% compliance. The main thing from the back of the room that you should be able to see is that both lines are going up. Now, what did we learn from these two different graphs? This is hospital survival. So as you get greater degrees of compliance, patients had higher and higher survival. And these are adjusted graphs, already adjusted for patient age, for their Apache 3 scores or severity of illness, and for mechanical ventilation. So don't think that they just had greater survival because they were younger or because they had lower severity of illness or because they were less likely on mechanical ventilator. All three of those huge covariates have already been adjusted for, and so the bundle itself was an independent predictor of increased survival in this 5,000, over 6,000 patient study. Now, what's the difference between the left graph and the right graph? The left graph is total bundle compliance, and the right graph is partial bundle compliance. The real beauty of looking at these side by side is to realize that there is a dose response, and the left graph doesn't adequately reflect the dose response because it treats bundles as either an all or a none. Either you complied with all seven, all six components or seven components of the bundle, or you don't get any credit at all. The true dose response, it shows up so nicely on the right graph where we give credit for partial compliance. But the overall take-home point is better compliance, higher survival, even after adjusting for age, severity of illness, and ventilator use. But that partial compliance gives you even a dose response here. So we can talk maybe in the Q&A when we're having our panel here about different of you in the room wondering, well, we like the D part, but we don't like the E part. We like the B part, but not the A part. Let's discuss those nuances as we move along. Take home point from this graph, if you want to put numbers to things, look at the bottom row in this table, and you can see that by the compliance analysis using partial compliance, for every 10% increase in compliance, we saw a 15% increase in survival after adjusting for those covariates. That's what that 15% means. Now, the right number on the bottom right, the 23%, means this. Now, you might say, well, we're going to use the bundle in all of our patients, and we're going to try to improve survival. But what role would that bundle play in improving survival of a palliative care person? We started thinking about this as we were analyzing the data. A palliative care person who's being put on end-of-life care and have withdrawing support, they're going to die anyway. We're just, our goal there is to try and improve the quality of their dying experience, right? So really, they wouldn't reflect well in the whole survival analysis. So when we removed the palliative care patients, we found out that the true increase in survival was 23% increase in survival for every 10% increase in compliance with this bundle. Pretty dramatic improvement, very telling, and a very large study of over 6,000 patients that are already submitted for publication. So to give you a little ammo when you go back to your hospital. The second data point I'm going to show you here, and this is the last kind of nitty-gritty part of what I wanted to present to you, and then we'll move on to the last section of my presentation. Similar graphs, similar format. This is delirium and coma. Now, it's delirium and coma freedom. So when the graphs go up, as you can see, both curves go up as you increase compliance, that means more days alive and free of delirium and coma. So higher is better. And what you can see once again is that as you go across the x-axis from the left to the right, that both curves go up. On the left, we have total compliance. On the right is the one I told you is really a better look here at giving credit for partial compliance. And I summarize these graphs on this slide for you. After adjusting for age, severity of illness, and mechanical ventilator use, we found a 15% increase in delirium coma free days for every 10% increase in bundle compliance. I'm offering this to you as ammunition so that when you go back to your sites and people are arguing with you about the implementation of this bundle, you can say, well, the data that were presented at FCCM from Mary Ann Barnes Daly at Sutter Health in California are really, really should spark us to work hard at this implementation process. And then the last point is just that there was a 2-day difference in the amount of acute brain dysfunction as you went from low to high compliance. So that's kind of putting a tangible number on what does it look like at the population level. 2 days less of delirium and coma? I mean, come on, that is big time. That's face valid. That's something that your team should buy into. All right. Now, that's really the nutshell of what I wanted to present. I'm going to close with a series of slides making one point. You shouldn't do this because other people say you should. You should do it because you embrace the depth and the breadth of the literature that have proven this scientifically that it works. So since many of you in the room might be hearing about this as a bundle as a whole, the ABCDEF bundle, I am just going to show you some of the key references at each step. We're not going to go into the individual studies. We're not even going to look at the individual studies, but all of these references I'm about to show you are available to anyone who wants them off of the ICU Liberation website, or you can email me and I'll show them to you. So for example, at step A, people would say, well, what are the data within the bundle behind the assessment, prevention, and management of pain? And here you can see some key references, the peer-reviewed literature on pain that help establish the A of the ABCDEF bundle. The B, you can see here we've got papers from the New England Journal, Lancet, JAMA, the Blue Journal, very high impact references that establish the B for the journal. And then here, for the bundle, that is. And here are even more for the B itself. Just trying to make the point to all of you in the audience here that don't go home and let somebody say, oh, that was some silly thing they came up with, this bundle. There's really not that much evidence behind it. As we say in the Deep South, hogwash. There are a ton of data behind this. So the C, lots of data at the level of JAMA, critical care medicine, Lancet, JAMA again. So the C is well established. The D is well established. Here you have some very high-end references as well, JAMA, Lancet, Archives of Physical Medical Rehab, CCM, so on. The E, more of the same. The F, and I, you know, this was a lesson for me. I didn't know the depth of literature at the F. But here we have several different New England Journal papers, AJRCCM, JAMA. So the F is actually very well established as well. And it should leave us saying to ourselves, wow, with that much peer-reviewed evidence at each individual letter, that is something that I need to embrace as a clinician. But then also the last question would be, well, when you put it together as a bundle, as a whole, what is the literature there? And here are references just looking at the ATF bundle. as a whole. And these references don't even include the data I just showed you from Marianne Barnes Daly, which won top abstract at this meeting yesterday. Congratulations, Marianne. So we'll have to add a new reference to this slide for the bundle as soon as you get your paper published. And lastly, I'm going to bring it back home to what I think we all need to have our minds on the patient. This woman, a patient of mine, had necrotizing fasciitis of her face. We took her back to the OR numerous occasions to debride her face. I got permission to use this. She and I are writing each other letters about every month now. We've become very close friends. And when she was in the ICU suffering this way with bilateral infiltrates, hypoxemia, and ET tube down, we implemented the bundle very aggressively for her. Instead of letting her sit in the bed despite how sick she was, we were getting her up every day. We were doing spontaneous awakening and breathing trials. We were paying attention to not overexpose her to sedatives, to watch her delirium, to try and deal with the environment and the non-pharmacological ways to reduce her delirium. And so much so that on the day that she was finally extubated, passed her SBT and extubated, you can see she was walking down the hall beautifully on her own 2 feet, strong, with a minimum of critical illness or ICU-acquired weakness, and able to get back to her life. In bygone days, as her physician, this woman would never have been there because I wouldn't have done a good enough job of keeping her moving with the whole team. So this is what the bundle is about. It's also about better communication, keeping people awake and alert in the ICU. Here you see one of my patients who's a liver transplant patient waiting for that with bilateral infiltrates, pulmonary edema. He had AV malformations throughout his chest, which we will see go away as soon as he gets his liver, of course. But here texting his children with his wife looking on, wide awake with the ET tube down. And my favorite series of pictures that I've gotten in the last 6 months are these, which on the left through these period of five pictures show a patient who's deaf, intubated, unable to communicate with his mouth and unable to hear, but signing to his nurse back and forth, him signing to her, her signing back to him, and back and forth. And as I watched them do this that day, I thought to myself, can I just take some pictures? I whipped up my iPhone, took these shots. I said, I just want to remember this new day in our ICU, post-implementation of the ATF bundle, where I watched somebody who would have prior been deaf, dumb and unable to speak, in the literal sense of the word, and then delirious, because I would have given too much medication, etc. Instead of that, being awake and alert, totally communicative, and CAM ICU negative, and able to sign back and forth with his nurse. This is the new day we're looking for. This is about human dignity and about preservation of self-worth. And we love having all of you on board, and we look forward to having an open discussion with you after the next of our colleagues present. So thank you so much.
Well, we're going to start not with A, but with teamwork. And I think this is a real foundational part of thinking about this bundle and how to put it together. And the reason that I think this, let me switch the mouse around here, is that we have the patient in the center. And when we think of our patient, and we want to keep it patient-centered, we want to keep the patient at the forefront of our mind, and we think about these problems that our patients deal with that Wes already alluded to, so pain, agitation, and delirium. And we know already that they're complicated because they're really interrelated. And how we assess them influences one another. Their management will influence what happens with them. And our treatment and their outcomes will influence one another. So they're very interdependent, both our assessment and management of them and the outcomes related to them. And so when we think about managing these patients, we can't compartmentalize them. And we can't silo our care when we think about managing pain, agitation, and delirium. And so that's where we get this idea that we have all these interventions. And how do we put them together? other, and how do we keep them in some type of framework so that as we as a team care for our patients, that we can align that care. And that's what bundles do. It helps us, this big group of people caring for this patient in the center, it helps us to align our care. And when we think of the ABCDE bundle, that's exactly what it does. It helps us to put the patient and keep the patient right in the center and to do each component of this bundle. And it helps not only align our processes, but it helps align our people that are associated with our processes. So it helps our team figure out we've got to coordinate the handoffs between awakening trials and breathing trials, that mobilizing a patient is much more effective when that patient's lightly sedated, and that there's a synergy to that cycle. And we see that, but it also is true that it doesn't just happen without some coordination among our teammates. That we've got to coordinate and communicate and have good teamwork and coordination. And that's really a foundation of what this bundle helps to accomplish. Now, traditionally, and these are some slides from Marianne Barnes Daly, these are some slides that they use at Sutter Health in thinking about what is a team? Really, what's our definition of a team? We think of the traditional sense in medicine or in healthcare. What we've done is we really have had a team lead that's been a physician. And that physician has gathered some information and worked through various professional channels to gather that information. And usually, sometimes in a very siloed fashion, and then delivered a decision for the patient. And given specific siloed orders to those separate professions to deliver that care. So the end result is usually siloed care. And then we've moved over the course of time to this idea of multidisciplinary team. So if our team, where we gather our experts and we gather decision makers and we get input, we still have a team lead and we get input, and then we funnel still the main decision through that team lead, which for us is traditionally the physician that's making that main decision. And the physician makes the main decision based on the information or the consultation that he or she received from those various other professionals that were part of the team. And what we want to introduce today is the idea of a new type of team, the idea of an interprofessional team. And an interprofessional team, and I just kind of put these teammates here to represent that really behind each one of these elements of the bundle is the entire team. That this is an oversimplified example here. That if we were to think about each element of this bundle, it takes multiple team members to pull off every element. But if we were to think of who is the professional lead that pulls off the awakening trial? And who's the professional lead that might pull off the breathing trial? And who would be my key team leader that I should go to coordinate between those two things? It would be our nurse and respiratory therapist, right? Those would be our two folks to coordinate between. And so if we think around, kind of around our spectrum there, we see that when we think of our interprofessional team, we bring to the table experts in their professional domains. We include at that table, or let's call it the bedside, we bring to the bedside some experts, including the family member who's the advocate for the patient that usually can't represent themselves at that person. So family members, significant others, part of that team, part of that interprofessional team with us. And then there's a sharing from their professional expertise. Let me share about what happened with the awakening trial. Then what happened with the breathing trial? What's going on with mobility? How are things doing? Let's talk about what drugs we're choosing and why. You can see how each person is lending some professional expertise. And then we have a discussion, a collaborative discussion, keyword, a collaborative discussion, and have shared decision making. What do we think is the best next step? What are our action items? How are we going to prioritize our next goals? And we work together to make the next step. And that's really this new idea. And I think that one of the foundational things that we see with this bundle is it facilitates and helps us in ICU in the ICU to pull this off because it demands it. It says, in order to do this, you've got to pull this team together. If you're going to be successful, like Sutter Health has been successful, as we've seen in the previous slides, you need that team working synergistically together. And you need the team working in a collaborative fashion with one goal in mind, patient outcomes, improvement. So what are the tools that we can use? We talk a lot about what are the tools that can help us with doing these processes, the awakening trials, the breathing trials, what are the safety screens and the criteria, but what are the tools to help us improve our teamwork and our collaboration? And we've got a lot of those in place in various parts of our institutions and a part of our, even in the fabric of our units. We've got bundles, just like this ABCDEF bundle that we're using. The idea of bundles create a language to synchronize us with. So they help us to have a similar language among all of our professions to link multiple processes together so that the A is connected to the E and we get that connection. That some pain has something, has some connection, interrelated connection with mobility. Oh, when I'm mobilized, I need to be thinking about pain. So it helps us to make those connections. And what about role shadowing? I recently saw my Facebook site, a page kind of flare up with this Canadian physician that spent a day working as a role shadowing a nurse and relating his experience of what that was like to spend a day as the nurse. And just learning from another professional's experience what it's like to be in those shoes. What is it like to be on the other end? Patient care rounds is another way that we can build in our teamwork and collaboration and communication. We can gather also in huddles. We can gather and share collaboratively about the patient. And look at that. Oh. We're fighting. No, there's two of us. Yep, standing by. We can work in collaboration with one another. So in patient care rounds, one of the things that we have found to be incredibly helpful is the idea of having a script. So you bring the team together, but it's kind of like an awkward date. You don't know what to say to each other. So you've brought the team together, and now you need to give them some type of script so that there's expectations as to what's going to be said. Oh, the nurse is going to report like this. It's going to come in this type of format every time. And then we can digest it in the same way every time. And that's what we have used the brain roadmap for, is this idea of a script. And we report it, then we interpret it, and then we act on it or make a plan. And so it's a very predictable way for everybody involved. I don't know about you, but we've got a lot of rotation happening in our units, a lot of turnover, a lot of traveling through our units and folks showing up just for a couple weeks and going back out. And standardizing that communication helps a lot so that we have the information shared in a way that we can interpret and make a plan. Checklists. This is an example of the checklist that we use at the University of North Carolina in Chapel Hill in our medical ICU for the ABCDEF bundle. This is part of the nurse's report of how do we have a checklist that holds us accountable to make sure we've reported off. We've just got this laminated and we use a Sharpie in the mornings, and it's used in nurse-to-nurse report and also in sharing and rounds. And then there's a bottom part that's actually handed then to the physicians as they do the plan for the day, is marked some things off there. And then what about practicing it? And one of the things that we love to talk about is that in healthcare, we do a lot of handoffs and rarely ever train our teams to do any handoffs. We rarely ever equip our teams to hand off to one another in any fashion that, or how, what the framework behind that is, or improvement. And so what about simulation? Not just about our ability or skill to put in lines or to run a code, but our ability to work together as a team? And then what about role-playing or videos? And one of the things that the Society of Critical Care Medicine has done, and what I want to teach you about today and help train the trainers, you didn't know, but you signed up by coming today, that you're now all trainers by the end of the session. And you'll all be teamwork trainers. And we're going to walk through some videos that we have put together on doing some of these things. And you can take back to your units, and you can have some sessions with your teams and walk through with them. So I'm going to play a video, and in this video, there's going to be about 30 seconds here of just intro text. And what this video is it's a rounding experience. And then we're going to talk about it afterwards. So I just want you to watch it, and then we're going to walk through it afterwards.
Do you mind waiting in the waiting room while we make rounds on the patient? We'll only be a few minutes.
Yes, if you think that's best.
Now, we're asking families to leave the unit doing rounds. Okay, then, let's get started. Mr. Reed was admitted yesterday with sepsis. I know everyone is busy today, especially me, so I've written the orders on there. They cover everything. Just let me know if you have any questions, all right? Thank you.
Okay, so let's talk about that. So how did you, there's some words missing here. How did you feel when you watched this team interaction? So shout it out. I'm pretending like we're in a small, intimate conference room right now. And so how did you feel when you watched that?
Embarrassed. No connection.
Yeah, no connection, embarrassed, uncomfortable.
Ego.
A little bit of ego going on.
Unsafe.
What do you think in that video facilitated patient care? That, you're not allowed to say nothing. That's a rule, ground rules. Can't say nothing. Something had to, maybe.
They were at the bedside.
Good observation. She said they, so more than one person was at the bedside.
They had a checklist.
There was a checklist. What do you think hindered patient care? Yes, yes.
There was communication, but it was one way.
It was one-way communication. The way that it was not much eye contact happening by any member in the room. That family was alienated. There was no input in the back.
No commitment to the process.
No commitment to the process. Excellent. So one of the things, and we don't have time today to do this, but if you do this and you go back to your teams, a really great way to facilitate this conversation, because we're really quick to say, boy, that doctor was a jerk. If you think it was a doctor. And but really helpful thing, remember one way to enhance teamwork and communication is this idea of role shadowing. Maybe that doctor's had a really busy day and there's a lot going on in the unit. Six other people have coded. There's no time to have this conversation. There's not much going on, and that's all she could pull off. So I think that it's really helpful on your teams to use this phrase that's used a lot in simulation debriefing. Imagine if you had been that doctor, how would you have felt? Imagine if you'd been we're really quick to feel understanding or empathy for the family member. Somebody said, oh, that family member was so alienated. Oh my goodness, that's awful. I would not have left. What if you were the nurse or presumably the respiratory therapist in the back? How would you have felt? And this is a really great way to stimulate some conversation on your teams about what it's like to be in the other person's shoes. Because it's a great way for your team to learn what are the expectations that other person has or other profession has that you don't know anything about or that you've made some assumptions about. Let's watch another video. This is... Let me advance it here. Whoa, too far. A different way to do it.
Hi, Mrs. Reed. Hello, Mr. Reed. I'm Vicki, your nurse. Remember earlier this morning, I said the team would be meeting in your room to discuss your husband's care?
Yes.
Everyone, this is Mr. and Mrs. Reed, and they're celebrating their 43rd wedding anniversary this week.
Oh, that is amazing.
Well, congratulations.
I'm Debbie, your respiratory therapist.
I'm Jessica, the pharmacist.
I'm Elijah, the physical therapist.
And I'm Dr. Smith.
So let's get started. Is everyone ready?
Yes.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, I'll start with the brain roadmap report. Mr. Reed's target RAS score is -1 to 0. Currently, he is RAS -1 to +1, CAM ICU negative, with a numerical pain scale ranging from 3 to 7. His baseline pain level is 3. He's not currently on any sedatives, and he's received fentanyl 50 IV pushed twice for pain.
Now, Mr. Reed was not sedated this morning, and he passed his spontaneous breathing trial.
I believe the patient is ready to be extubated, and I'll take care of that right after round.
Mr. Reed, your mobility level is at a 3, so we'd like to get you up on the side of the bed and into a chair today, and we're going to do that 3 times, all right? We're going to assess your muscle strength so we can progress you into walking tomorrow.
Once he's extubated, I'll switch his pain meds and other medications to oral. I see Mr. Reed has Wellbutrin on his home medication list. Does Mr. Reed take this medication daily at home?
Oh, he takes his Wellbutrin every day.
Okay, fine. I'll submit an order for the Wellbutrin right after we're finished.
Debbie, let's plan to extubate Mr. Reed in 10 minutes at 9:45.
That's great.
I think we'll be ready around 10:30 to get Mr. Reed up to the chair. I'll put the green sign in the window so you'll know that Mr. Reed is ready. I'll also remove his urinary catheter so it'll make it easier to move around.
Great work, team. How does that sound to you? All right. We'll get you situated, all right?
Okay, so this is a different version. How did you feel watching that one?
Inspired.
So
lots of interaction.
There was a lot of interaction.
Each part feel like they knew that they have their own part and their own.
There were some designated roles of who was going to share what.
Patient was involved.
The patient was involved. Family member was involved. What in that video interaction facilitated patient care? They were at the bedside.
They involved them and asked direct questions about care, medicines. What were you ready for?
There were direct questions about care, medicines, readiness to do the next things, involved the patient and family member in planning that.
Set expectations and goals.
There were some set expectations and goals communicated to the whole team and patient and family. What in this video hindered patient care?
There wasn't any exchange of medical information except for the medication. There wasn't any discussion of vital signs, laboratory work, of x-rays, something like that.
Right. It was kind of a snapshot, pulling out some ABCDE-specific stuff from the rounds, lacking the whole rest of rounds, the information that we would typically get on rounds. Mm-hmm.
There was no coordination. Each one of them functioned parallel to the other.
Seemed like they were functioning parallel to one another. Imagine, again, if you play this video with your team, that you would want to go through that same thing. Imagine if you were this person or that person. Typically, when I play this video, folks tend to think it's the home run compared to the previous video, that this was the better video and the previous video was the bad video. So That's not what we're necessarily communicating today. It's just examples of how it looks like when it's worked out. Because some people would say what hindered patient care in that video is that it took too long. And how could you do that with everybody? How could we, that really, you can't really do that. I can't pull that off. That's really not feasible. Now let's see one more. And this is later that same day on that patient. So let's see how well they did making a plan.
So Mrs. Reed, let's review the plan and see if you have any questions. The respiratory therapist assigned to your case will be in a few minutes, and she'll remove the breathing tube. We'll allow your husband to get some rest, and then the physical therapist will be in to help your husband get out of bed and into a chair. We'll also add the Wellbutrin to your medication list. What questions would you like to share with the team?
Well, I'd like to get him, help him get washed up before he gets up into the chair. And when he's at home, he likes to wear his bedroom slippers when he's out of bed. So I brought those. Would it be okay if I help him put those on when he gets up?
Certainly. We'll get the supplies that you'll need for his bath. And it's perfectly fine putting his shoes on when he gets out of bed.
Okay. Thank you.
So, Mrs. Reed, do you remember earlier today when I mentioned that the care team would be coming to your room to discuss your care?
Yes, I remember.
We include the patient and the family as part of this team, and we depend on you and Mr. Reed to assist us in meeting the goals that we've set for today. So please help us to keep on track.
Okay.
Are there any other questions we can answer for either of you?
No, I don't think so.
Well, Vicki, I just want to update you. Dr. Smith didn't write the extubation order. I've paged her, but I won't be able to perform the SVT without the orders. So, you know, I have other patients to see, so I'll be back later.
Vicki, what's going on? I thought Mr. Reed was supposed to be extubated by now.
No, Dr. Smith did not write the extubation order, so it's been delayed.
Okay, well, I won't be able to be back for a couple of hours, so I guess just let me know. See you in a couple of hours, Mr. Reed.
Okay, so how did you feel watching that video?
Where was the nurse practitioner?
Frustrated.
Yeah. Frustrated. Where was the nurse practitioner? Someone asked up front.
And did they throw the physician under the bus?
I love it. This phrase often comes up when I've played this video, is why did they throw the physician under the bus? And that is an excellent question about teamwork.
It's not a team. They air their dirty laundry in front of the patient.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Brenda, I also want to add that the physical therapist should have stayed in the room about the patient about that. So,
yeah. Right. Right. The see you later this afternoon. Right. Mm-hmm.
And the extubation should not depend on the physician writing that order. That should be an automated part of the protocol.
Right. Right. And so you can walk through these same questions. And what I really like about having this video and using it, and what we recommend with these videos, is that you may not have time to walk through all three of them, but that you use two together, because it's helpful to compare one to another. And I like comparing video two to video three, because you can end video two thinking, wow, things went really great, and then realize, oh, but just talking about it and making a plan about it on rounds doesn't mean it happened. And it still highlights that there are some processes and some teamwork issues with this team, and that there are ways that they might be able to improve their communication and the way that they interact, and also the way that they work with improving their handoffs and the ways that they're coordinating one step, each parts of the bundle. Now, these are all available for you. This is your take-home gift. And so if you go to that ICU Liberation website, you click on bundles, you can go right to this little area down here, and there's a facilitator's guide. There's a PDF that tells you all about debriefing and the questions to ask and different questions you might pose and some examples of prodders. And then there's the three video links there. So you can take this home and try it out with your team. You might even want to try it out with your family members. I'm going to save the questions till the very end, and now I'm going to pass the baton to Mary Ann Barnes-Daly, who's going to tell us about putting the F word in the ABCDEF bundle.
And I remind you folks, we're Twittering ICU Liberation. It's hashtag ICU Liberation.
Very nice, Brenda. Thank you so much for that extraordinary information. And we're happy to know that those videos are now available for all of you. One thing I'll just say to tag on to Brenda's presentation was that when you saw the team in the room and they were being interprofessional to a good extent, when the respiratory therapist said, "I've performed the SBT and the patient passed and they're ready," one of the things we do in our team is we have each person in the team say the words, "I recommend." So you'll see that there's a little bit of passivity around the respiratory care practitioner. The patient passed her SBT, and then the physician said, "I think the patient can be extubated." So when we're looking at decision-making, shared decision-making, collaboration, it's important for each member of the team to say, "I performed an assessment. I recommend the next action." And that's where we provide each member of the team equal power, equal contribution, and we recognize them as an expert in their own domains. So I just wanted to add that on. So what did Wes call it? The avant-garde topic, putting the F in the ABCDEF bundle. I'll share that I have no commercial affiliations. The Institute of Medicine defines patient-centered care for us as care that provides, is respectful of and responsive to the individual patient preferences, their needs and values, and ensures that all patient values guide clinical decisions. Our new SCCM president yesterday, Dr. Todd Dorman, used a term that I appreciated. He referred to the patient as our North Star. I think there's been a lot of discussion at this meeting about ICU burnout for physicians, specifically providers, and also for nurses. And I think one of the other things that he mentioned in his talk yesterday morning was kind of putting the caring back into healthcare. I think we all talk about ourselves as healthcare providers, but we are care providers, which means in addition to providing and adding our areas of expertise to the patient's care, that it is so important that we use empathy and caring and know that that person in the bed is a human being who deserves our care and empathy. How's this working for you? Okay, great. Okay. So ask yourselves then, how involved are the families and the patient when possible in your ICU? And then for the remainder of my section, I want you to think about a situation where your loved one is in the bed, you're the family member, and sometimes that's even harder for us, right? Knowing what we know and what happens in ICUs. How hard would it be then for your loved one, your wife, your daughter, your mother, your husband, to be in that bed? And what would you want out of your experience as a family member? How are families treated in your ICU? Do you include the patient and family in rounds? Really important in ICU Liberation for the reasons that we saw. Not just to provide information to family members. We don't want to so much talk at them. We want to listen and gain information from them. Are your family members allowed to contribute to the plan of care? In our unit, in our model that Brenda showed you, the patient and family member is a part of the rounding team. They have the ability to contribute to information that's shared bidirectionally and to actually help us with creating the plan of care for the patient. Are family members' concerns addressed, or are they just tolerated? Do we look at it as a chore to respond to questions like, yes, so we sent the UA and we're waiting for the results, we'll know what to do next. Even using jargon as something as simple as a UA, patients and families don't know what that is. You really need to check your language. Doesn't mean we dumb things down for them. We need to be clear and honest. But we need to use language that's easily understandable, because whenever we use a word a patient or family doesn't know, we confuse them and they can't hear anything after that because they just feel dumb and they're afraid to ask us. It's very important. There are some myths and misconceptions about having family members in the unit, that they interfere with care, that they tire the patients out, you know, that it's a burden to them to have to be there. And I know, especially as nurses, we sometimes say, please go home and get some rest. We promise that we'll take care of your loved one. But they don't want to go. They don't want to go because they're scared to leave their loved one alone. They're scared to leave the care up to us sometimes. So we have to think about why are they there exhausting themselves for so many hours? What is it that they feel we cannot provide to the patient that they can? And there are many things. There's a myth that patients spread infection. Honestly, when you live in a home, you've been exposed to most of the germs that are there. They probably have a really good ability to be resistant to germs brought in by their own family members, as opposed to germs brought from us, or more importantly, from the patient next door. The reality is that social isolation and separating patients from their families does them harm. Families know the patient's cognitive function. They can provide really important information about baseline cognitive function that can help us assess for the presence of delirium. Many U.S. hospitals restrict visitation. And a little over half have policies that support visitation. But honestly, how many of you have worked in or continue to work in a unit where a family member needs to be outside these locked double doors and pick up a phone and call in to you to ask if it's okay to come in? That's like prison. The only thing that we do differently than prison is we don't frisk them and x-ray them for guns. But honestly, when you think about it, their loved one is locked behind a door and they don't have access. Think of the anxiety that might produce in you if that was your family member lying in the bed. The National Patient Safety Foundation Institute talks to us about safety in the hospital. Patients and families play a critical role in their own safety. When we educate them to understand what it means to have a safe experience, they can help us. When we say, please, if someone approaches your husband and hasn't washed their hands, please ask them to. If you think that your mother is acting a little funny, please let us know. That could mean something. She could be developing sepsis, or she could be developing delirium. Often patients' loved ones are the first ones to know, way before we do. I tell my friends and family members, don't go to the hospital alone. If you ever get hospitalized, please call me right away. Imagine, I'm in the healthcare profession, and I'm afraid for my friends and family members. I think we all want to be advocates. We need to let their loved ones be advocates for our patients. Be sure that you understand the plan of care. Again, using jargon that patients and families don't understand, or being kind of cryptic about what we're going to do for them, that doesn't help. We need to instill a level of confidence and trust in our patients and our families. It actually improves their outcomes. Patient and family engagement. We all hear that as a buzzword, patient-centered care, patient and family-centered care. It's not a buzzword. It's there for a reason. It's not just the new flavor of the month. It's the right thing to do. And again, put yourself in that position. Isn't that what you would want? There are three elements to consider about patients and their families. They will always, particularly in the ICU environment, have concerns and fears. And often they're unique and things that we wouldn't even think about. Sometimes we provide information to them in kind of a rote way, and we think we've told them everything they need to know. And they may have a question that we didn't even anticipate. We need to ask them and give them time to speak with us and respond respectfully and provide them with the information that they need. We need to provide them with knowledge and skill, either to help their patient their loved one recover, or to understand why it is we're doing what we're doing. It's not enough for us to know. They need to know too. They're part of the team. They will help the patient improve far beyond what we can often do. What systems do you have in place that promote patient and family engagement? We need to have mutual respect for each other, skill and knowledge, honest, two-way, clear communication. We need to provide interaction with the family and the patient that is clear, that we let them know we understand them, and be empathic. Put yourself in the patient's and the family's shoes. How would you feel and what would you want? Creating mutually agreed upon goals when you plan with the patient and the family is only going to help you gain success. Shared planning and shared decision making among the ICU team is important, but it's also important between the patient and family as they are integral members of that team. This is so very important and something we know cognitively but often don't remember in our hearts. These people, it's not ARDS in 1312. It's not the pancreatitis in room 4B. These are people. Think about yourself. I know we've all read books and papers written by healthcare providers who have now been on the opposite side of the spectrum and have become patients. And what do they share with us? And how saddening and embarrassing is it to learn what they experience as patients? It changes their mind. It changes their practice. But we need not wait for ourselves to be in that position to learn from them. We need to realize that we are delivering mechanistic, non-empathic care. And it's not okay. It's not what we would want for ourselves. It's not what we would want for our family members. It's not right for our patients. We need to remember that as we cross the threshold to every patient's room. Humanity in our care should be the highest priority. Because really, the patient is there to get well. The family is there to support them. But think about the reasons that we're in the ICU. Some of us are there to get a paycheck. Some of us are there to finish our residency or our fellowship. Some of us are there because we like teaching. Some of us are there to conduct research. But honestly, we need to put those reasons second to the fact that we are there to provide not just our intellectual input to the patient's care, but we are there to provide a healing environment for our patients. And that means from the heart, from the head and the heart. 13 years after a paper written about opening the door to our ICUs, we have made some progress. And today, the main resistance is from us, the healthcare workers. Do we ask the patient's wife to leave the room every time we turn the patient from side to side? How many of you have done that? What is it that we do that the patient's family can't see? If they can't see it, I'm wondering what it is we're doing. Very important. Why don't we want families in the room? We need to be able to operate with people looking at us. Maybe that actually makes us even safer. Family's presence at the bedside is not a privilege that we bestow upon them. It is their right as a loved one and as an American citizen to not be separated from their loved one just because they're in an ICU bed. And the open ICU isn't just, oh, you know what, we now have 24/7 visiting. That's not what it means. It's not just about expanding the hours of visitation. It's about how the family and loved ones are invited in, how they're treated, how they're included. Physical touch, it's been known for a long time to improve things like immune function and recover from illness. Who best to have close to the patient touching them than their loved ones? Move the machines out of the way, put the side rails down, and let these people touch each other like they do when they're home. Imagine yourself in that bed. What would you want? Would you want to be separated by a CVVH machine from your husband? I don't think so. As we do these things and engages the family, it increases their confidence. They trust us, and they will go home and get that rest that they need. They trust us, and by association, all the next healthcare providers that they'll come in contact with. An open ICU means daily meetings with the family, and what better time to do that than in ICU rounds? And often say, oh, they take so much time, they ask questions. We limit that. We say, if you have some general questions, we'll be glad to answer them during rounds, and we really want your input. If there's anything in more detail, we promise to come back and talk with you about it later and answer all the questions that you have. The anxiety level just drops dramatically, and they sit and wait patiently for you to do things that maybe are more urgent. We need to work while being observed. It makes it a more safe environment. ICUs are not doctor-centric or nurse-centric or care team-centric. They need to be patient and family-centric. We need to remember that every day we walk through the doors into our unit. Does this actually increase our workload? Or do more relaxed patients and less anxious families actually, does it decrease our workload because they're not actually honest all the time because they're scared about what's going to happen next? Facilitate unrestricted access to one person. We all have those families that drive us nuts. There's 47 relatives. They all want to talk to us separately. There is a way to deal with that. Choose one communication person. We can limit visitation if people are out of hand or they are causing distress to the patient. We can do that. A great model are units who have family coordinators. They have people who are specially assigned to be liaisons between the care team and the family. They can answer a lot of the basic questions, and there are something that they need to add. They can come to the care team, incorporate the patient and family in the discussion. What a great idea to have a specialist. In our ICUs, we have lung specialists and heart specialists and renal specialists. Why don't we have a family specialist? Wouldn't that be important? And wouldn't you love that if you walked into a unit where your loved one was in the bed and there was a family specialist to help you navigate the patient's trajectory through the ICU? The way that family visitation and open ICUs benefit patients is that it decreases their anxiety, their confusion, and their agitation. It's been shown to reduce CV complications. Research has shown it decreases ICU length of stay. It provides feelings of safety and security. It increases patient satisfaction, and who doesn't want to do that in this day and age? And it increases the quality and safety of the care that we deliver. The family benefits are it increases family satisfaction, and they're the ones often filling out the surveys. It decreases their anxiety. It promotes communication. It contributes to our better understanding of the patient, and don't we all want that? It allows for more opportunities for us to teach the patient and the family, and it increases the family's involvement in care when often they can provide some basic needs the patient needs so the nurse actually doesn't have to. Family members can help by doing many things that you see listed here. It's really important to provide information to the family and say, here's your role as the family member of this patient while you're in the ICU. And if you don't understand any of this or you need more information, please come to us. The last thing I'll say is we need to prepare patients. It's no longer enough for us to steer the patient through their critical illness, help them survive, and transfer them out through those double doors, and then forget about them. You hear a lot now about post-intensive care syndrome. We have our own society-based program called Thrive to help patients succeed after they've gone through the horror of having a critical illness, to deal with what happens to them after they leave our unit. Patients and families don't have a lot of appreciation for how much trauma this hospitalization has caused them. We really need to let them know what to expect, that they might feel depressed or anxious when they get home. They may even have PTSD, and what to do with those feelings. They're not abnormal, but if you have them, then perhaps you should seek help. And here are some references. Resources. That's the word. Here are some resources when you have drain damage from being in the ICU. Consider including some of this information in discharge packets for your patient so that when they get home and the dust settles and the fog clears, they're like, gosh, I should be feeling okay, but I feel horrible. I don't want to do anything. I don't even want to walk my dog. Why is that? And say, oh, look, this is normal, and here's how I can be helped. When the patient's at the bedside, who better to help the patient sort out reality from delusion? And we know that many patients in our ICUs have delirium and are delusional. The patient's family helps them sort out reality from delusion. and helps with memory enhancements. Many units successfully use something called an ICU diary, where either the patient can write in, but more often the family writes in things that happen to a patient on a day-to-day level, day-to-day basis, that the patients don't even remember. And when they do come to, or their delirium clears, or even when they go home, they have a full account of what happens to them, and it helps them to understand how sick they were and why they feel the way they do and what enormous stress they their brain and their body has been through. It helps them to understand and assimilate what's happening to them. We need to develop rapport with our families. We need to set expectations for them and ourselves. And we need to provide education so they can be productive and educated and skilled members of our teams. Family presence decreases anxiety, increases satisfaction, and provides our interprofessional team a more personalized view of that pancreatitis in bed 4B. Families provide protection for their patients. They facilitate communication. Most of them are excellent historians about what's happened to the patient before and now. They can coach the patient toward improvement. Family members are an integral part of the patient care. They need to be recognized for the contributions that they make, and they need to be invited into the world of the ICU. Here are some associations who support family presence and participation in the ICU. And here are some online resources for family, for you and for families to use. Thank you very much.
Good morning.
Afternoon.
Greetings from the great state of Ohio. I won't say the Ohio state anymore. I see this is the very smart group who chose to come to the ABCDEF collaborative talk as opposed to the new sepsis definition. So let's all applaud you for that very wise decision. My name is Michelle Ballas. In the next couple minutes, I have the great pleasure of sharing with you all of the accomplishments that this group has made to date. I'm going to share with you some of the great creative ideas our partners have come up with about getting the ABCDEF bundle into your ICU. So it should be a lot of fun. As Wes said, we do have a mission, and we started this, what is it, about almost a year ago now that our collaborative officially started. And one of the purposes of our mission was to create those teams. A lot of emphasis on the teamwork. Lean, sustainable, highly functioning ICU teams that partner with patients and family. And we're going to do that partnering through the ABCDEF bundle. So by now, I don't think you have any questions about what the individual letters mean, but let's talk a little bit about how you can get them into your everyday care. What we were interested in, we have very different interests, but one of the things that we really wanted to emphasize is the importance of process change. So if we were to implement the ABCDEF bundle, how does that process change affect our patients and their families, right? A lot of people need data. A lot of people need to see the objective mounting evidence that actually doing this very hard, complicated work is of benefit. So if we make this process change, is it going to be a good change? And how are we going to know it's a good change? And how are we going to know that all of this work that we're doing over the course of the year mattered? We define in our collaborative success in a number of different ways. So we're going to have success measures in terms of what you would think would be successful, right? Well, hopefully less patients will die. We'll get them out of the ICU earlier. They'll have better physical, functional, and cognitive outcomes. But we're also very interested in measuring other important outcomes like we heard about at the very beginning from Brenda in terms of our teamwork. Are we doing better as a team? Are we playing better in the sandbox together?
And of course, with the triple aim, we want to do all of these great things at the same time reducing costs, right? We can't put enough pressure on saving lives, making everybody happier. We have to do it with decreased costs. So you met many of the ICU Liberation Steering Committee members, but I do want to mention, I heard Heidi somewhere in the room, but also joining us is Ken Hargett. I don't know if Ken's here, and Joanna Stalling. One thing that you'll notice is we really try to practice what we preach, and everything we do, we want an interprofessional perspective to really learn from each other, to make the thinking a little bit less linear at times, more creative and out of the box, and getting the opinions of multiple professionals helps us do that. We've divided the collaborative into three separate groups, and the West Coast, we have a West Coast group. Are any of you here from the West Coast? Yay, West Coast! You're led by the great Matt Aldrich, and you already met Marianne. And Heidi, Julie Barr, I didn't see her here yet today, and Tamara Kelly and Alex Morris, our 4MD. The Midwest, I didn't see my buddy Bill Schweikert. I wish he was here, really great guy from Penn. And myself are heading up that initiative in conjunction with John Devlin, the great PAD leader extreme. I see John in the background, Ken, and we've been responsible for those efforts. And then finally, we have our East Coast faculty. You've met Brenda, Dr. Shannon Carson. It took me a while. I always thought Shannon was a female for the last 5 years. I really was reading all this great work by Shannon Carson, so I just assumed naturally he was a female because it was outstanding. But no, really, Shannon is a male.
Somebody tweet that, please.
No tweeting! I don't even think I've actually met him in person. But Lawson is joining us from our respiratory therapy. Chris Perme, another excellent physical therapist, brings so much to the team. And I don't know if I mentioned Cheryl. I think I might have missed Cheryl there. We have some phenomenal subject experts that help develop the content that we're using. I know Wes told a story and you know gave you some sense of how much evidence is behind this. I can't believe people still argue about the evidence behind the bundle. Like, that's one of the things that makes me just want to stab my eyes out. But I'm going to call out Ken back here. Ken was so nice. He actually came to our Midwest Collaborative on the day his daughter was getting married. Brilliant, dedicated, or really in trouble by his wife? Not sure. But Ken helped us with the part of the B part of the bundle. And he was so organized. He actually made a binder and had only the B references in the bundle. Do you remember the binder? I am not lying. Just the B. Ken? This big? At least this big for the B. So I think if we stacked all of the bundle things, literally we're talking at least a Brenda Pun height kind of level. Heels. Really overwhelming amount of evidence behind that. But we do. Kathleen Pontillo, the goddess of pain, and I say that in the greatest way imaginable, has given us so much insight in terms of how complicated pain assessment and prevention and management in the ICU are. My friend Jim Jackson, who I hear is suffering at home with a fallen tree in his backyard. And the great Pat Post, even though she's from Michigan, we were not going to hold that against her for now. That's twice I got you today, Pat, in terms of all the great work she's done with quality and safety initiatives in the ICU. Of course, none of this could happen without our fabulous support staff. Diane, Vishaka, Lori, I guess she got stuck in those silly sepsis guideline things. But really, the amount of work these tremendous women have done to make this collaborative happen, I'm surprised if they were men, they'd probably be hairless from pulling out all of their hair. But the amount of behind-the-scenes effort in terms of coordinating a collaborative effort this size, really tremendous. It's a big effort, and I'm going to show you. All right, so in terms of the ABCDEF then and now, I remember this was probably not even about a year and a half ago when we first started talking about really putting these things into paper. How could we make the PAD guidelines and the ABCDEF bundle work together so we have a nice, sticky, tight message in terms of getting these evidence-based interventions out there. So it started with, I think, Wes scribbling on his iPad on the plane, and if you ever get those text messages, you start thinking, what is this man doing, and why can't he use Microsoft Word? But really, love you dearly, but really, it's been an evolution in progress, just figuring out the nomenclature, like what does the A stand for, and making it all stand that way. But developed nicely in the last year and a half. Now, Diane's here, and she didn't sign a disclosure form. I'm going to look for her for some answers. It's a big collaborative. At last count, we have 66 adult intensive care units. 68. That's why they're here. And 9 pediatric intensive care units. So do we have any of our peds colleagues in here? Yay, we have one. Soul? Oh, two. Yay. Pardon me? They all met yesterday. So again, our PED sites working on their own separate collaborative, getting some of these looking at the possibility of getting these interventions into everyday care. You can see, I don't know what happened with those kind of loser states in the middle where there's nobody there, but I'm calling out also, I know there's people living there, also calling out my Puerto Rican friends that are in the front row up here. The hospital on the map is actually bigger than our almost 51st state. So obviously we've gone through a series of different stages in terms of planning the collaborative. What should we do? What should we do? I think on 1,000 occasions I was told this is not a research project. You can't have everything that you want. Bring it down and think. Don't think as big as we could. There's been a lot of creativity and initiative behind some of the things we came up with. I'm just going to take you through some of the stages that we went through here. So this is, we had a meeting back in June 2015, so yeah, not even a year ago, where we came together and said, okay, how the heck are we going to get the educational part of this done at least? And that's where we really thought about what is the education that the teens need when they go back to the ICU and start implementing this. So a lot of team building and strategizing about, oh yeah, no, that was I like the words. Everybody brought their own presentations that they thought were fabulous. Oh yeah, that was real. Okay, I'm not going to tell you who this was. That was a phenomenal presentation, but you need to shorten it by 45 slides and don't use any words. So we had a lot of revisions from trying to make, again, the way we're teaching more congruent with adult learning and adult learning strategies. We then had this really fun series of bundle regional meetings. So we got to travel through the three collaborative sites, and we had a two-day meeting. Now, again, importantly, so when you go back and you're implementing this into practice, they were not 2 days of ABCDEF lectures. And I don't know who the wise person was. I'm going to guess it was maybe Brenda Pun on this one, but or maybe Pat Posa. I don't be corrected by saying this, but in fact, I don't even think we talked about the ABCDEF bundle at all on that very first day. Imagine that. That first day was really focused on that emphasis on teamwork and team building and communication. Left some people wanting more, but they were great the next day when they got what they wanted and we taught them what they came for. But really emphasizing, again, you got to get your team and your communication down before you could do this or it's not going to work. So brilliant, brilliant, brilliant idea, whoever that was. We are a good-looking group. Just put that picture in there to emphasize that. There's Bill Schweikert again. In part of this collaborative, not only did we have the, again, traditional PowerPoint, here's the evidence, you're kind of silly if you don't believe it, but go ahead, give us your best questions. The participants also had the ability to work with these world-renowned experts like John Devlin, like Julie Barr, in person to ask the questions that are burning, that sometimes people are afraid to step up to these mics and ask. So they had that opportunity to work with our faculty to really strategize about what are they going to do next when they go back into their practice setting. They also had some dedicated alone time. I'm going to say not enough, but they did have some time where they sat, not silently, but they were with their group as a team, and they were just able to talk to each other. The other people that they work with in their own intensive care unit that they probably see on a daily basis. But they had that beautiful alone time so they can actually start brainstorming about what they're going to do when they get back. And participants really seemed to like that. So again, just maybe a little helpful hint that having that dedicated time as a group, I would suggest doing it over maybe a fine Merlot or maybe a Pinot Grigio, depending on the season. But having that alone time to team build from that aspect, getting away from the intensive care units to get to know each other as a team, very important. I love this picture because this was our first draft of our data collection tools. And you look at the, yeah, what are they thinking up there with those tools? That's a lot of pages up there. I'm not sure what we got into. But they, the participants were also exposed to what we were proposing to do in terms of data collection. We did this really neat exercise. Again, we have all this information available for you in terms of if you want to use some of these strategies. It was not a team. This wasn't team building. The shapes was more like a person. You know those personality tests that you take to find out what you are? I was a square, not surprisingly. And one of my good friends, Diane, actually turned out to be a squiggle. And what we had the people, the participants do this because certain personalities, you pick these shapes out of the blue, just pick a shape, whatever shape you want. People are attracted to these different shapes, but theoretically, what it's supposed to do is to give you into some insight into how they think, what's important to them, what kind of creativity skills that they use. So as you can imagine, squiggly people are kind of like all over the place, making people happy, really strong people person, don't care a dang about details. You put them with a square like myself, who's all about the base, all about the details, figuring, you know, what are we going to do now? What are we going to do? What are we going to collect? How are we going to collect it? Kind of could be challenging. But the beauty is, I think when we took the test, every single one of us was a different shape. And you really need that squiggly person. When you're ready, you know, you're on your 15th revision of this, the protocol that people are using, and people are complaining that it's unclear, you need the squiggly person to say, it's okay, don't worry about it, take a step back for a little bit. So the importance of picking team members for this implementation that might not be like you, because I don't think I'm going to want to work with another square for a long time. Our teams got really creative, but in addition to, I'm going to share some of that creativity with you. As a group, we also partnered with the AACN, American Association of Critical Care Nurses, has been such a great partner in this effort. We really can't let, I don't know if anybody here is from AACN, but we really have to mention the partnership that they've had with us. One of the things that we did was to, I think it was Brenda and Diane, AACN CSI presentations, where we started working with them to share some of these teamwork, culture safety, progressive mobility kind of things with that group of providers as well. You saw the wonderful videos. Those videos took a lot of time, patience, and work, and they were such a great icebreaker, if anything, at the meetings that we have. And now they're available to you for you to take back and hear and do that team building exercise as well. Data collection, what everybody's kind of interested. How are we going to measure our process and patient outcomes? Very important to measure, right? Because when you go back and you advocate, hey, we need another nurse on day shift so that we can do the SAT and the SBT coordinated, or we'd like to hire another physical therapist so that we can get our patients more mobilized, you have the objective data in hand to give to your administrators to show why you need this. Look, this is where we are. This is what our patients look like when we're at this level of implementation. Let's go forward. So we our sites are collecting data, God love them, on a number of different variables. And I'm just going to briefly talk about, I'm not going to share all the different details. But the first one is administrative data. So this was important, we figured, because we know intuitively, right, that a number of administrative factors will probably affect whether or not your implementation efforts will be successful. So we're collecting things like whether or not, are you an open unit or a closed unit? With the assumption that maybe processes are better in closed units where there's an intensivist model. We're also looking at things that have been actually pretty neglected in the ICU literature in terms of staffing. Because I won't be surprised if you go back and you find out that one of the major barriers or impediments to implementing this is we don't have enough people. We don't have enough people to make this happen. We can't walk our patients. There's simply not enough staff. Okay, well then let's have some measure of staff. So we're looking at the number of respiratory therapists that are involved or pharmacists involved in the unit. What's your RN to patient staffing ratio and things like that. We're looking at rounding patterns. We'll know if there's any changes in ICU rounding before and after the collaborative. We hope by the end our goal is to have all of our teams rounding on a daily basis with their family members. But again, we need that measure of beginning phase. Where are we, and then where are we going to, or where are we in the end, to see that change over time. We're also looking at things like some of the more global mortalities, hospital-acquired infection rates, and things like that. More survey-related things, we are using two different tools. The first one is the AITCS Teamwork and Collaboration Survey. So a survey to get a sense of how well the teams are functioning in terms of teamwork and collaboration. Again, graciously, the American Association of Critical Care Nurses allowed us to use their Healthy Work Environment tool. I don't know how many of you have filled out the Healthy Work Environment tool, but that's part of the surveys that we'll be administering to our collaborative members to get a sense of what the work environment was pre-collaboration and then after the collaboration. Hopefully, we're developing, in addition to great evidence-based interventions, hopefully we're also making a more strong and resilient staff in a healthier work environment. We also have an ICU practice and perception survey, and this was self-created by our team, where we're actually looking at very specific ABCDEF related practices. And I think it's cool, not just because I'm a research geek, but I think it's cool because it not only measures staff's perception of whether or not they're doing it, but it measures things like their confidence. Their confidence level and their skill level in terms of these interventions. Confidence means a lot, particularly with an administration of tools like the delirium assessment tools and things like that. I can do that. I feel confident that I can get my patients up and mobilized every day. In terms of patient, that's the major survey components. In terms of patient and family-centered outcomes, we're doing two different things. The first thing we're doing is what we're considering our baseline data. And so for our baseline data, we asked our collaborative sites to collect data on 5 patients a month for 6 months. And we have a standardized data abstraction tool that they'll be using, and that'll serve as our baseline data. And then going forward, we're going to have them collect for a total of 12 months worth of prospective data collection for the patients that are visiting their unit during that time period. To be included, we're going to be collecting data. There's no restriction on whether the patient's mechanically ventilated or non-mechanically ventilated. We'll include both patients in the data collection tool. And we have very few exclusion because, again, we want to keep this as real world as possible and most applicable as possible to the real world setting. So everybody you can take, unless they died or were discharged from your ICU within 24 hours or that they were actively withdrawing care in the 24-hour period. We have two different plans. I'm not sure anybody's going to take the Cadillac version. I guess that's a good question. But we were thinking maybe we have some overachievers out there. Oh, well, there you go. We do have some overachievers. Anybody here from the collaborative take the premium plan? No. The Southern folk, go imagine. In general, so the two different plans, it's really comes, the difference between comes down to how many patients you're going to collect data on. So with our standard, I want to use the correct terms, we are collecting data on the first 30 consecutively admitted patients each month. All right, again, vent, non-vent, doesn't matter to us. First 30. People that choose the premium can choose more patients, and they can actually choose to collect data on more days in the intensive care unit, so over 14 days. So if you're with the standard plan, we're enrolling those 30 patients a month, and we're following them for 7 days. No identifiable information is being collected. I had to make that clear for IRB purposes, but we aren't collecting any data that has HPI patient level data that the patients can never be identified. But we are collecting things that you would consider important in terms of a quality improvement collaborative, demographics, severity of illness, residents pre and post admission and discharge. Our ABCDEF daily compliance form, I'm not going to take you through the specifics, but we break it down by the A, B, C, D, E, and F. And basically, what we focus on is we want to know Are the collaborative sites assessing for example, pain? If so, how many times have you done that in the 24 hours? And are you using one of the PAD recommended pain scales, so the CPOT or the BPS in terms of the pain? We asked very similar questions in terms of anxiety and agitation and delirium, looking to see the incidence of those symptoms as well. We're also collecting information on whether or not they received the other evidence-based interventions. So did they get their SAT today? Did they get their SBT today? What kind of medications did they receive in that last 24-hour period? Are they getting things like benzodiazepines or antipsychotics? And then finally, in terms of the family, again, we didn't want to ignore the family completely, so we're collecting data on family visits. Was there a documentation that a patient was visited by their family member in the last 24 hours and things like that? So I'd like just to tie the lecture up with sharing a couple of the really creative things that our collaborative sites have sent us. And unfortunately, I don't have all of them in there. I just picked out a few that came to me in the last couple weeks. But I thought it nicely illustrates that creativity as we move forward. Right now, like I said, we're not even midpoint, I don't think, through the collaborative. We're still having our monthly calls. We have a great education, usually education-related topic during those calls, and then a lot of learning from each other, where we have the sites share their experience with us about what they're doing and have they been successful or not. Listserv and frequently asked questions on our website and things like that. I love Albert Einstein. So great creativity, like I said, poster boards galore, ABCDEF related, really taking back the educational presentations that we have, putting them up in their units. Particularly, I just got an email the other day that, oh my God, now it's in the bathroom again. So they're doing that, a lot of in-bathroom educational experiences in terms of the ABCDEF bundle. But it's funny, it wasn't in the nurse's bathroom. It was in, I guess, all staff and all family bathrooms as well. So pretty interesting. VA Tennessee, look at how beautiful some of these pictures are, in particular with the hand and the courageous caring. But a lot of our sites have been having people sign their commitment cards. So the staff in their units are pledging that, yes, I'm going to do this. I'm going to give my patient the best evidence that's possible, and having them actually put their signature to that commitment. I like this one. Again, this is Sarasota. I don't know if Sarasota's here, but this ICU liberation one, again, taking it down, easy sticky points. We know our ABCs, putting it up there with the letters and sharing it with family members as well so that they know what the ABCs mean. Rounding tools galore, really took off on the rounding tools. Here's some great examples. I couldn't put everybody's in here, obviously, but really great rounding tools that, again, help emphasize what Brenda Pun was teaching you about what should be talked about on rounds. And St. Joe's, here we go, Pat Poses. Pat had this great idea. You know how nurses carry the cards around their chest with what to do, race, is it still race, rescue, alarm, contain, stuff like that. You know, so we have, 50 cards now. The nurses walk around halfway, with the iPad back, just from the amount of cards that we carry around. But we have a great one now for the ABCDEF bundle. But it's a great creative way to remind the nurses who will now be presenting on rounds, and that causes some angst for some people that don't like public speaking. Okay, this is what I'm supposed to say. So the first 1 or 2 weeks, your nurses might be going, hey, okay, A, their pain, B, yep, they got the awakening and breathing trials, but having it right there in front of them so that they could get comfortable with the language that they're using. I thought that was great. This is my personal favorite. I am a kind of Jeopardy geek. But Lakes Region General Hospital, Lakes Region here? How creative is this? Anybody else like Jeopardy? They made a Jeopardy game. And again, we have this available, I think, to freely share. How you don't have to do this. It's done. Somebody very creative did this for you. So it's this ABCDEF Jeopardy game. Remember this? Pick a number, blah, blah, blah. Everybody ready to pass? Oh, it was going too smooth. Got it, boss. Jeopardy. Perfect. Thank you. Here we go. You ready for your questions? Vital signs are an important indicator for patients in pain. Yes or no?
500. No.
But then they give you the answer too. So, like, let me go back. So this is what the, what your staff will see if you decide to use this game. You pick a number. It goes to this slide. Then it also gives you the answer. How cool is that? I'd recommend, again, maybe a little present or something for the Jeopardy queen on the unit. I'm just assuming it's going to be a woman. Jeopardy queen on the unit. But great idea. Look at how beautiful this is. Phrenology? Is that how you pronounce it? There's the smart people. Phrenology map. Remember how they used to, or I guess they still do, map out the brain with, you know, Wernicke's area, Broca, blah, blah, blah. Look at how beautiful this is. Someone had the creativity to do this and have it with the think mnemonic, which we use to, again, for rounds, passing around the ABCDEF bundle. A lot of excitement with new rounding and groups wanting to share their new rounding. I don't have it, but a lot of pictures of the first mechanically ventilated patients up and walking as well. So that's all I got. We'll end with Kettering, and they're, oh, look at how beautiful. They even have theirs in a beautiful silver picture frame, their commitment board. So really, kudos to our collaborative sites. They are teaching us so much as we go along, and this is going to be a great, great project that will hopefully shape the future of critical care for years to come. So thank you all if you're involved.
As our panel joins the stage and prepares, I would like all those folks who are a part of the collaborative to please stand up. Fantastic. Once again, it's hashtag ICU Liberation.
I'm wrong, we're mic'd. Well, this is an open section of our symposium, and we really just want to know what you want to know. So it's open forum, fair game, any question. What is it you'd like to know? Please come up to the microphone, identify yourself, and ask whatever it is that you'd like to know, and we'll do our best to answer. And if we don't know answers, we'll get them for you at another time. The mic needs to be on for the. Yep. There you go.
Yep.
Majdi Hamarshi, St. Luke's Health System, Kansas City. So about the data collection, my understanding that someone will be filling on A or B has was done, was not done. Who will be doing that? Is that like a third party watching what's going on and filling that? Or the nurse
sure,
herself?
At each participating site, it's a little bit different. They've all designated different people. And at some sites, it's part of the nursing staff, it's research staff that they've brought along. Some sites, it's part of their quality improvement groups doing it. And it's just pulling data from the chart and entering that into the data collection forms.
They don't have money to go hire somebody else, so people are being very creative about coming up with the existing staff who really have a passion to do this. So it's somewhat blood, sweat, and tears, but you'd be imagining how creative people are getting about doing this.
Trying to pull reports from your electronic medical record. I'm the person at UNC right now, so it's pulling data from your medical record system if you have an electronic one.
So we're not part of that collaborative, but we have an EMR. So I imagine if I volunteered to collect the data for that, it's not clear in my EMR, and we use Epic, yeah. And where was the sedation vacation done or not?
Yeah, right.
And also, breathing trial, well, I can't find that. Usually there's an ABG, there's CBAB, I can't figure it out. But about the other elements, was mm-hmm. it done or not? How you feel about the validity of the data?
You know, I think the validity of the data, we have spent a lot of time among the faculty and the members of the collaborative to be very specific about what each point means, and so being very specific about data definitions and what when you can answer no and when you can answer yes for every single thing. So I think in terms of the validity of the data at the end of the day, I think we feel really strongly about that. And guiding the teams is if you don't find it documented, then it didn't happen. And so I'm pulling data from Epic, and I'm weeding through these charts looking, and it's been incredibly enlightening to our team that one of the things that's been some self-awareness that we've had part of our interprofessional team growth has been realizing that we see different things.
And they're documented.
Realizing that to the depth that it's true, I think everybody understood in Epic, which is what we have, is that we see different screens. The physicians have certain screens and flow sheets pulled up. The nurses, the respiratory therapists, the physical therapists have different screens. But how different they really are, and how valuable it would be to have an ABCDE flow sheet that we all could click on. And so some of our efforts have been working with other sites in the collaborative that have already created that, and they've already worked with their Epic team to actually create that so that we could go to our team that says, don't come to us for the next 6 months because we don't have time for you. And maybe for the next year, we're not taking any new changes. And we're adding 17 new hospitals. That's an exaggeration. So we can't change anything. You know, so there are real challenges as to making sure we've wrenched in and making sure every member of our team knows how to wrench in the right thing. But actually, the data collection, had we not been doing that, we would not have realized how we don't see and how we don't realize, oh, you were doing this all along and I wasn't seeing it. It's not part of the sheet, the flow sheet that I call the flow sheet. We were all calling something the flow sheet and it was something totally different. And so it was real enlightening just looking for the data together was really helpful for us.
That answers my question. And I want to conclude with what you are doing. We're not part of the collaborative, but what you are doing, Wes and everyone at Vanderbilt and all of you, is enlightening. And it's not only impacting patient outcomes and experiences, it's also impacting physician career and passions and what we do. We, our health system, we came up with that Epic ABCDEF sheet, and we are working on it, and we are moving forward. And thank you for what you're doing. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I just want to bring you back on. You and I spoke yesterday about the summary flow sheet that you're developing, and I started with 7 hospitals. Now I'm moving the project to 14 more hospitals, and it's challenging, and the data burden around this initiative is great. And so as we all try to optimize our EMRs, it's really important to create functionality where discrete fields can be drawn from and this data can be automated, because it is not sustainable. Manual data abstraction is not sustainable. And I bless all of the collaborative members who are really working arduously to collect the data. But really, as you're all preparing to do this, create that single IC liberation summary flow sheet where no matter where the respiratory documents or the physician documents, it all flows into and populates a flow sheet that can be automatically abstracted to remove the data burden so that we can really show the results of our hard work.
Please.
Hi, my name is Bridget Cram. I'm a clinical pharmacist at Duke University Hospital, and we're in the midst of implementing a lot of these initiatives at our hospital, and I'm getting to be the team lead in a lot of that, so it's great.
And you said Duke?
Yes, I'm at Duke,
Excuse me. Folks, could you please turn the microphone up? It's difficult for everyone to hear. Thank you.
My question is surrounding one of our largest barriers, particularly from the nursing staff, is sleep, and how to promote sleep in these patients with keeping them at lighter levels of sedation. So oftentimes come in the morning and I'll hear, oh, my patient got propofol last night or Presidex last night to help with sleep, and we have to talk about, you know, how to, you know, improve in restorative sleep. So I guess that my question is, what do you guys do in your practice to help improve sleep quality for your patients?
Exercise them.
Sure.
Yeah, I was going to say, the first thing to do regarding improving sleep is to realize the obstacles to good sleep. And one of the obstacles to good sleep is over-sedation with medications which suppress slow-wave sleep. So overuse of GABAergic drugs, for example, make the patient unconscious, but are all the while suppressing slow-wave sleep. So ridding your patient of overuse of those medications will avert the iatrogenic creation of absence of sleep when you actually think that they are sleeping. So one thing would be the SATs and the SPTs which are the steps within the bundle that reduce drug use. So that's a pharmacological approach, but it's removal of pharm rather than giving pharm. Because you might be thinking, most of the time when somebody asks us, how can we improve sleep, they're thinking, which sleep drug can I give them? But instead, we think of taking away drugs, and we think of exercising the patient. So getting your patient physically exhausted through mobility will get them to sleep naturally without the need for the sleep aids pharmacologically. So the first two steps are removing offending drugs and exercising your patient more. And notice that we don't then even talk about adding a drug until you get through those plan A, plan B. So third level of intervention would be a sleep drug.
The ACN, they have a part of that CSI initiative, and if you can go to the website, you can search these. The Bay State Medical Center did a great CSI project on delirium and sleep, and it was Don't Be Delirious, Take Sleep Serious, and they have a really hilarious video associated with that, music video associated with that. But I think that they did a real big strategy that also involved everything that Wes said, in addition to changing the environment. So they, changing some care, making sure the evening time was actually a time that you could sleep.
Sure.
I'm going to just bring Wes's comments down to a more granular level. It begins with disabusing the nurses of the misconception that giving the patient a sedative puts them to sleep. It's that simple. And we all work all tirelessly all day to get our RASS scores to zero, only to come on and have the night nurse have over-sedated a patient thinking they were helping them rest. And we all know that sedated patients help the nurses rest, right? But there is really, truly a lack of educational understanding about the use of sedatives and the obstacle to sleep. And honestly, start with that granular level to say, you are causing your patients to not sleep by giving these medications. I think 50% at least of the nurses would be surprised to hear that.
Now, I'll give you one more bit of data that might be useful for you. Some people at your institution might not care about sleep. So you do, and some others might. But if they don't care about sleep, this idea of disabusing them of the idea that drugs make them go to sleep is also, you could get at this another way via failing spontaneous breathing trials. So we published a paper in Critical Care Medicine. Chris Seymour is the first author, if you want to pull this paper just so you can find it. So S-E-Y-M-O-U-R. He's actually speaking in the sepsis thing right now. We showed that more drug received and more delirium nocturnally equated to a dramatically higher likelihood of failing a spontaneous breathing trial the next day. So your patients are much more likely to fail their SBT and stay on a ventilator if they get more drugs at night for sleep.
Interesting.
Pretty good data point.
Makes sense. Some people really don't know the connection between sleep and the meds.
Right.
I mean, I don't remember learning that in undergraduate education. So an important part for our pharmacists, that would be great for you to make a poster for the bathroom. Because some people really, really don't know. REM sleep, non-REM sleep. I mean, these are pulmonary sleep, critical care docs. They all get it.
Right.
But it could be an innocent mistake.
Sure.
And people might truly believe that, the unconscious patient is the sleeping patient. So I would recommend the bathroom.
Thank you.
Education material.
I find that it comes a lot from our providers and from nursing staff both, so it's, I think, a common misconception across the board. But
maybe they don't know.
I don't know.
Yeah.
And listen, we're really glad that Duke's a part of this, and the Duke Pediatric Hospital is also a part of this.
Okay.
And I guess, are you on the adult side?
I am.
So thanks for being a part of it.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Next question. Peter.
Hi, Peter Sprung from the Netherlands. This has been an excellent session to start with. And probably we have another letter here after the F to G of glow in the dark, because then we have to go on to sleep. I think that's indeed very important.
People have suggested, you're going to keep going, people have suggested G, H, E, I mean, all the way on down.
Yeah, we were up to K already. So
Some people want G for goals. We're keeping ours to F, but if you want to add a letter, feel free. By the way, Peter Sprung is a well-known intensivist from the Netherlands, as you just heard him say, but I wanted you to know that he is one of the people who first identified that if you don't actively look for delirium, you will miss it 75% of the time. He had a beautiful paper on this topic. So, Peter, it's wonderful to have you here, and thanks.
Thanks, Wes. So, actually, that's coming back to the question that I'd like to ask. It has to do with implementation and changing behavior. I'm so glad that you all pointed that out so adequately. And what I'm struggling now, actually, in the Netherlands, because we're going out there and teaching people using videos, etc., how to perform bad, not in addition to the other things, and then, you know, go back and we have trouble either, like the charity is then doing, getting people to their unit, but we always think that we should go out there and teach people in their own environment, because, you know, there are always things that you don't think about that are happening. So, but changing behavior, going back to that. So, at least in my country, there are more and more and more things that the administrators, but also the insurance companies, want us to do. So the effect would be that although we want to do 50 things, we should do them, because every individual thing will make a difference. But are we really capable of doing this? And will in the end, will it not be the result that that the implementation level will go down, and in the end, you just are swamped in all this data, and your quality actually will go down. So how will we maintain this level of, you know, good performance and implementation level? So what do you guys think about this? You're the expert. So how to maintain what we should do?
I'll just say that the three women are going to answer here, because Marianne has her Sutter Health experience, real world, 7 ICUs, she's moving to 14. Brenda is doing this firsthand at Chapel Hill, and Michelle already published a paper on critical care medicine. So please address this issue of part of the bundle versus the full bundle, and most importantly, sustainability. Maybe we can start with Michelle and just work our way to the other two of you.
Yeah, I'll go quick to let the other experts talk as well. I mean, you've got a great point, right? There's so many quality and safety initiatives right now, CAUDI, CLABSI, sepsis. We'll ignore that one. But all the different initiatives, how do you pick and choose which one, right? Well, I think I'm just going to make 2 points. First, I think we have strong evidence right now that this will help our patients. I think our evidence will build as we do these quality improvement projects, how much more it'll help the intensive care units, so you'll have that administrative buy-in. I know it sounds tacky, but there's nothing that we have in our bundle that isn't humanely the right thing to do, because it's built on evidence and because we know that it helps people, and because the fact that it emphasizes the patients and the family, putting them centered. Hopefully patient satisfaction scores will go up, administrators like that, right? So hopefully you'll see, and that's why we have the data collection occurring, not just because we want papers to come out of it. We want the sites to show that their hard work pays off, and this is how it pays off. But you're right. So we'll get our ICU length of stay down to 3 days. We'll only have 10% mortality, whatever it is. Okay, next, right? It's going to be, I think, something that we face over and over again in terms of what's the hot topic and what's the right, but it's the right thing, it's the right care to right do to right now, or whatever the saying is that
we had a hospital in the Netherlands, and they went to a competition and so sort of against the health insurance companies, and said, okay, we have to do 1,000 guidelines in our hospitals. So that's not going to work. So they analyzed which guidelines that should be in place in the first place, which guidelines actually made the biggest difference in their setting. So they chose to do the top 20, focus on that, forget about the rest. And I think that's a sensible way of approaching these kind of things. But regarding PAD as well, or several parts of the bundles, in a certain setting, you may have to make choices in your particular setting, because certain things are already organized pretty well, because they are ingrained already. And in other settings, other things might be important. So I think this is a message we should all get out there as well. So if you're not doing all parts of the bundle, you're not specifically doing a bad thing.
Correct.
It could be very good, actually. So, but in the end, what you already pointed out, the result counts. What happens to the patients? So, I don't know what you think about that.
Well, you know, one thing that I like to teach about the ABCDEF bundle is that it's a little bit different than some other bundles because I think it's wallpaper. I think it's the wallpaper that's on the room, that should be on the room of every patient, every ICU patient, because it's the backdrop care of everything else that we're doing. And, you know, that in that context, then we care for the septic patient, the alcohol withdrawal patient, the liver patient, the, you know, whatever the patient's condition is and the issues and concerns, whatever organ is failing, we care for it on the backdrop with that happening and managing that. And so one of the things that's what I like to teach for sustainability is this is backdrop. This isn't the wallpaper. We want to make this a part of our system. So it's just that it's what we do. It's already things we're doing. So let's just organize it so it's easier to do for us. Let's help ourselves. You know, when Ed Vasilevskis published that ABCD paper, he said it aligned, you know, using that tech phrase, aligning people, processes, and outcomes. You know, that idea or technology, aligning people, processes, and technology. Let's use it to help us do what we're already being told to do because of those guidelines and those regulations. Because many of these things, people are coming to me all the time, I need to do this now, because the Joint Commission's holding me to many of these things. And they're asking me, why don't I have X, Y, and Z in place? And I need this bundle in order to get most of those things in place.
And thank you, Brennan. I'll just add two things. To your point, the data that Wes shared with you, looking at the dose response of the bundle and outcomes, shows us that even when applied imperfectly, the bundle can improve outcomes. So if you can't bite off, you know, you can't eat the whole sandwich at one time, then start with the things you can do. And logically, most people just start with sedation reduction and delirium assessments. Those are the first two and easiest things to do. We know that each day spent in the ICU delirious increases mortality significantly. Really important. And I think one thing I'll say about the sustainability and learning a new thing, many of my hospitals really pushed back saying, oh my gosh, you're asking us to do this next initiative, the next flavor of the month. But what they learned after doing this for about 6 to 9 months was that this wasn't an additional thing. This was doing what they do differently. And it did change their ICU. And the biggest complaint I had from the staff in the ICU is that our ICUs are now louder. What do you mean they're louder? Well, people are talking a lot. Nurses and doctors are talking to patients, and patients are talking to their family, and they're talking on the telephones, and they're walking around, and the halls are more crowded. And yes, it's changed my ICU, but I'm actually working less because patients' families are taking care of patients, and patients don't need as much because they're out of bed in the chair reading the newspaper. And again, we need to think about not adding another thing, but changing the way we do things that are going to be better for both us and for our patients. So it's not new and more, it's just different. Kathleen, you had something in the back?
Yeah, I just wanted to add to this. I'm Kathleen Bowman. One of the things that we don't do is look at routinized behavior that we have that has no science, no efficacy, no anything to it, and we just hold on to it because we've always done it that way. If we can clear some of that clutter out, then we can make sure that what we're bringing in is not just more on top, but literally filling those spaces with the sound science. Mm-hmm. And that's both from a nursing and a, you know, all caregiver professions.
Yeah, it reminds me of what Brenda did once. She went to do a continuing medical education program at a hospital, Kathleen, and on their flow sheet, they had this neuro section on the flow sheet. Now, I've subsequently repeated this jillions of times at other hospitals. And they said, we can't possibly do any more because our flow sheet's already filled with that much neuro stuff. And Brenda said, what if I could take this much neuro stuff out and put in a Svelte neuro monitoring package of target RAS, actual RAS CAM? It's narrower. It's actually more information, more valid, more reliable, and yet it's more Svelte. So, yeah, clean that other stuff out of there that wasn't validated in the first place for MICU, SICU patients, for example, and put in something that is more appropriate. Organize it better.
I think we had a question in the front first.
The lady.
She's been waiting.
Oh, you've been waiting. Go ahead.
Hi, Marie Pavini. I'm an intensivist in Vermont. I wonder what you think about physical restraints, and if you don't like them, do you use them anyway? How often? What type? If somebody's unrestrained, you have a monitor.
Okay.
So kudos to the new PAD guideline that will be addressed in the next guidelines that will be released in, what, 2 years?
Mm-hmm.
I think
she wants an answer now.
She has to wait 2 years.
So we'll keep you posted.
There's no tip to this one.
That's
now,
my question. Further disclosure, I went to the University of Pennsylvania and studied with some of the greatest nurse scientists in the country around geriatrics. Physical restraints right now, the evidence, if you're asking if we have randomized control trials to support tying another human being down to the bed, and does it help? No, there's no randomized control trials to support that practice that's in everyday care. The argument's always going to be the exception, not the rule, I think. What if they pull out the tube? I can tell you several studies that looked at what happened when the first of all, physical restrained patients, it doesn't mean that they're not going to pull out the tube. If you've ever been with a patient, they're restrained, they just scooch down and pull it out this way. So the restraints a lot of times are ineffective for the very reason that you're using them. And the data also suggested that when the patients do self-extubate with restraints, they don't necessarily need to be re-intubated, which may suggest, not causal, no randomized controlled trials, suggest that maybe they don't need to be intubated and they wouldn't need the restraints if they weren't intubated in that vicious cycle. So more to come. Obviously, you can tell my bias.
Additionally, we know that often patients need to be restrained because they're delirious. They don't understand what's happening to them, so they want to pull their tube out and run out the door. So when we take measures to reduce delirium, avoiding benzodiazepines, avoiding over-sedation, keeping people in the bed, when we avoid things that cause delirium, we often avoid the need for restraints, period. And there's that period between when you take them off and you haven't quite gotten to mitigate delirium yet, where that's a little bit scary. But I'll encourage you to take that first step, because again, we've seen patients who are delirious in the bed, tied down, trying to get their tube out, who are now sitting out a bed in the chair with their tube reading the newspaper. And so you have to take that first step to move in that direction. And it is scary, and sometimes the nurses actually have to stay in the room a little bit more.
Now, I'll add two points about this very specific question. Let's say that you're in the ICU, you're a team member, and you have this agitated patient who is only remaining on the vent because of the degree of their agitation.
Yeah.
So you could either say, well, actually, they're ready for their extubation. Let's go ahead and extubate them and deal with it. Or if you judge, though, as the physician, as the healthcare professional, if you judge, it would be unsafe to remove the ET tube at this point, which is very commonly a scenario, then you have to make the decision, well, what do I do then? Do I physically restrain them to prevent the tube from being yanked out because they're hypoxemic and can't have the tube removed, or do I give them a medication to do it? So it's an argument between physical or chemical restraints. And since I like to stay as evidence-based as possible, I'll tell you that I stayed up pretty late last night writing an editorial to accompany a randomized controlled trial that will be out in March. And so stay tuned for more data. I literally can't say what it is yet, but I will tell you that what she talked about is right up the right alley of the results of these data. In other words, there are things you can do, such as give medications which don't suppress respiratory drive. That might be the right answer in that circumstance. And, you could tie them down physically, or you could choose C of the ABC. CDF bundle, the choice of drug, you could choose more wisely to give a chemical drug which would not suppress respiratory drive. There's several options in that regard. You could go an algosedation that suppresses respiratory drive a little bit. You could choose alpha agonists. You could choose antipsychotics. So there are other ways to go other than physical restraint that might actually have outcomes data coming out pretty soon in support of that route. Okay, please.
I'm Brian Williams. I'm from UT Southwestern. I'm trauma surgeon intensivist. We're Parkland Hospital is one of the collaborative partners. Mm-hmm. And for the skeptics in the room, I just want to say that this bundle has transformed our ICU within a matter of months.
Okay. Very cool.
From a trauma surgeon. Trauma surgeon.
Surgeon.
Yeah, I'm the lead on this project, and like the real key was empowering the nurses to take ownership of each part of the bundle and bringing their ideas to the table and then implementing them. And I just pretty much stayed out of the way. And there's some paternalistic pride, because all I can say is that I'm proud of what they've done, because they've just done things I never would have thought of on my own. And although Parkland is under a lot of regulatory issues and pressure, you know, resistant to change, because a lot of things, we've been in the news a lot in the past few years. This bundle has really made a huge difference in how we operate in the ICU. And literally, we're in the embryonic stages, and I'm excited to see what's going to happen like within a year from now. It's going to be a totally different place.
Listen, I'll tell you, thank you so much for that affirmation. Just FYI, I wanted so much for Parkland to be a part of this this collaborative. I really did. I'm from Shreveport, Louisiana. I grew up in the north. I used to ride them alligators to school. You know them, man. And I've always just admired so much about Parkland. In fact, I wanted to go there for my residency or fellowship, but it wasn't good for my wife, who's a pathologist. Just, you know, the planets needed to align there. But when I heard that Parkland was considering being a part of this, I really, really pushed for that. And so that means a lot to hear that coming from you. Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Thanks and congratulations.
I know it's getting late. Are there any other thoughts? Maybe one more question, and we'll free everybody up.
Just quickly, I kind of chuckled when you had the videos about the holding up of the orders. Do any of you have bundles where your therapists, after the spontaneous breathing trials, are allowed to make the independent recommendation and extubate themselves? The therapists extubate.
Yeah, I'll give you a data-driven answer on that one. When we first did when I was a chief resident, I organized that spontaneous breathing trial study. We published this in the New England Journal of Medicine way long ago, 1996, I think. I didn't have much gray hair back then. What we found out in the subsequent 2 years, after we did that first New England Journal paper, was that the respiratory therapist had no autonomy to keep it going, to get from the screen to the SBT and to get from the SBT to the extubation. And patients were getting stuck on the ventilator for days longer than they needed to because of this block in the protocol. So, and this was at our institution where the actual original study was done. So we had meetings with the respiratory therapists and the physicians back in the late 90s and undid that. And we allowed the respiratory therapist the autonomy to move that forward. It was not easy. We had to get the buy-in of the physicians to allow and have the confidence of those respiratory therapists to do that. Subsequent to that, now move on to a national scale, the University Hospital Consortium, so-called UHC, did a study, J.P. Kress helped to process these data, in which we found that the average hospital, and these are high-end hospitals that know these data, the average hospital kept the patient on the ventilator 2 days longer than they had passed their spontaneous breathing trial for similar reasons that you saw in that video. So we recognized it was not a local problem, it was a national problem. And in many of our practicing collaborative sites now, they have moved way beyond that physician order mandate. And they've allowed it to be an opt-out circumstance. So that, in other words, the patient's going to keep moving through the protocol unless somebody specifically gives them a reason not to do that.
The reason I ask is because the ARC has developed guidelines, evidence-based guidelines. I mean, we're an organization that would love to collaborate with this and have some input.
That's great. Are you with the ARC?
I'm a member of the ARC.
Yeah.
I'm a respiratory therapist.
Sure.
By the way, our institution uses Epic, but the build on it was getting it to the point that getting everybody to get everything in. The other thing was getting it out of the box. If they don't fit the standard breathing trial, how can you input a note that the rounding physician would see, and you know how you communicate that?
So, yeah. Anyway. Okay. So the AARC is the American Association of Respiratory Care. That gives us a great idea. Thanks for your input, Vishaka and Diane. Let's make sure that we start communicating between not just the ACN, but also the AARC and so on and so forth. Let's connect these silos.
If I could just give a real world response to you. So small community hospitals where physicians were struggling, they relinquished control of rounds, and everyone said, I recommend, and we followed that. But they were still a little bit reticent to relinquish their control over the patient being extubated they wanted to lay eyes on. And so what we started with was we started with the respiratory care practitioner saying, this patient passed, I recommend they get extubated. And then the physician would come in and they would concur. And then we moved it toward, I recommend they be extubated, I'm just going to give you a phone call. And they said, okay, if you think it's good and you talk to me on the phone, you can do it. And now we're moving toward where the physicians have enough trust, where it can be an automated protocol, where now if the respiratory care practitioner
per the criteria of the protocol says, I recommend extubation, they can extubate the patient. So for those of you that, you know, are struggling with this, starting with those small steps and taking it, you know, one step removed at a time might be a way to help with success around
you,
that.
You said the key word, the trust.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that has to be built.
Yeah.
Have to be built.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Appreciate it.